Hello everyone, welcome to the MIF++ seminar. It's a great pleasure to introduce Professor Leonid Polterovich from Tel Aviv University, who will talk today about oscillations and topology. Over to you, Leonid.
Okay, thank you very much. So, well, it's a pleasure to be here. So thank you, Vitaly. And I will indeed talk about oscillations and topology, and kind of starting point is that many interesting objects in nature do oscillate, so you or fluctuate. Yeah, so you see oscillations in various subjects, from celestial mechanics to crystals. Yeah, and one physical example which is relevant to this talk is wave functions, for instance, of spin, of kind of free motion on the round sphere. So these are just spherical harmonics which oscillate in a very non-trivial way. So as you maybe can see on this picture, kind of.
Leonid, yeah, very nice pictures. May I ask if you could try the full screen mode?
Then I will have a certain.
If you, for example, press Control L in Acrobat, usually it goes to. Yes. Is it convenient for you?
No, it's not. So it's not okay. So just a moment.
Okay.
Yeah, no, that's I'm not sure. Like this. Yeah. So. No, I will stick because I mean there is okay. Some technical reason by which I will stick to the original.
Okay, no problem. So the slides can be still visible.
Configuration. Okay, so so here you have examples of spherical harmonics which are taken from Wikipedia. And I mean, this is a kind of 3D plot. So you see that there are a lot of oscillations here. And the question is how to keep track of them. So the rough idea is that if you have a function of two variables, so keeping track of oscillations is a complicated problem. I will talk about its history.
Leonid, can you hear us?
Yes.
You seem to be frozen.
And now?
Mm-hmm.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me now?
Yes. Okay, fine.
Okay, very good. So what I will do in the lecture. So it turns out that there exists a convenient algebraic or combinatorial tool for bookkeeping information on oscillations and topology of sublevel sets of functions. Okay, and so let me, by the way, I forgot to mention that this is joint work with Lev Bukhovsky, Jordan Payet, Iosif Polterovich, Igor Shelukhin, and Vukashin Stasavlevich. So it's a kind of joint, in a sense, Tel Aviv Montreal enterprise. And so we looked at applications of tools from topological data analysis to the study of oscillations of functions, and kind of quantitative flavor of all the story is stability. So we, what do I mean? So we encode oscillations of a function by barcode, and it turns out that closed functions have closed barcodes. So this means that even if we made a kind of a little error in description of the function, so our barcodes change do not much. And next idea, it's the main idea of the talk, that we will apply these tools from persistence, from, if you wish, topological data analysis, to study of oscillation and nodal sets or zero sets of linear combinations of Laplace-Beltrami eigenfunctions of manifolds. So these are far-reaching generalizations of the spherical harmonics I started with. And we'll get a coarse analog of some classical results, like Courant and Bizeau theory. So basically, I mean, what I will talk about is a joint work of my co-authors of 2000, 22, and there is another work which I probably will not have time to mention, is application of the same techniques to transcendental Bézout problem in several complex variables. It's very recent work. Okay, so you know, I mean, when you teach differential geometry, so somehow a very fancy way to introduce the subject is that there is an interplay between local geometry, curvature, right? So between differential geometry and topology of a manifold. That's probably one of the kind of most exciting themes in topology. So in a sense, in this talk, you have interplay between topology and, well, or analysis or geometry, depending on your taste, of smooth functions. So kind of smooth, it's function theoretic kind of cousin of the interplay between geometry and topology. Okay, and this is basically the idea which I will try to emphasize. And so if it will be clear, so then I kind of succeeded in my task. Okay, so I will start with a brief description of algebraic formalism. You certainly heard it several times. So these techniques of barcodes appeared in the last maybe already 15 years in the context of topological data analysis. So barcode is simply a finite collection of intervals with multiplicities. And so intervals will always of the form aj, bj, where b could be infinite and aj is finite. And given two such objects, we define a bottleneck distance between them as follows. So we say that two barcodes are delta matched for delta bigger than zero if, after erasing some intervals in b and c of length less than two delta, we can match the rest in one-to-one manner with error at most delta at each endpoint. So the guiding principle is erase and the line. Yeah, so you can erase some kind of small bars, okay, of length less than delta, not necessarily all, and the rest should be aligned in such a way that error at the endpoints is at most delta. So for instance, in this picture, we erase some topological junk and match the remaining bars. Okay, and we call the bottleneck distance between two barcodes infimum of such delta. Okay, and in the kind of with the, my assumption on the barcode, it's a Jeanian distance. Of course, I mean, note that infinite rays cannot be erased because they have infinite length. So we always deal kind of, it makes sense to talk about bottleneck distance for functions which have the same amount of infinite rays. But well, this usually, I mean, at least on closed manifolds, so it's completely prescribed by topology of a manifold. Okay, so now these barcodes appear in the following purely algebraic context. So persistence model. So the theory of persistence models goes in the package with these barcodes, and this is some fancy linear algebra which becomes very useful. So persistence model is the space of finite dimensional vector spaces parameterized by real number t. Okay, so we usually assume that these spaces vanish when S is very negative, and they are stabilized when this parameter is kind of very positive, and the extra feature, extra structure, which this family has, is a family of morphisms, pi s t from vs to vt when s is less than t, okay? And the main feature of this morphisms is just neutrality, is persistence. Yeah, so if S is less than T less than R, so natural map from Vs to Vt composed with natural map from Vt to Vr gives you a natural map from Vs to Vr. Okay, so I will use some extra axioms to make this, which are not really necessary, but they make the theory kind of user-friendly, and namely regularity. So this means that our spaces change only at a finite number of points, yeah? And moreover, there is a kind of semi-continuity at this jump point. So they kind of can change on the right, but not on the left. Okay, I will not go into this detail. So this is the main kind of axiom, which please keep in mind. So a very nice example is so-called interval model. So what is interval model? It's the following thing. So take interval AB as in definition of barcode, either finite or semi-infinite, and just consider the following persistence model. So over each point of the interval, you have one-dimensional space, which is just our field F, and otherwise it's zero. And morphisms are either identity or kind of or zeros. And so this is, in a sense, the simplest non-trivial object you can imagine. And the structure theorem, which is essentially proved with the help of linear algebra one, I would say that for every persistence module, there exists unique barcode, so that our persistence module is direct sum in the natural way of these interval models with corresponding multiplicity. Okay, so somehow persistence modules up to natural notion of isomorphism, it's the same as barcodes period, right? So as we defined them. And we will play with this combinatorial structure in a quite essential way. Okay, so now I'm ready to pass to function theory, right? So assume that we have a compact manifold. So actually, let us think about closed manifold. So I have a compact manifold without a boundary, and F is a Morse function on M. So function which has in this setting finite number of critical points, and it's kind of quadratic near each critical point. So that's what Morse theory means. So it has very, very nice kind of singularities. So our persistence module is the following. So we consider a sublevel set F less than T and take homologies with coefficients in your favorite field. And so reminder is the following. So actually, already non-trivial object is the H0, which is responsible for the number of connected components. So H0 of a set in this context is just the vector space over our field whose dimension equals to the number of connected components. And more generally, I'm just reminding that HK, so k-dimensional homology, is span of k-dimensional cycles over boundaries. Okay, you will see some picture in a second. In this way, this definition will be refreshed. And so persistence morphisms are induced just by inclusions of sublevels. So if S less than T, then F less than S maps to F less than T. And so we get a perfect persistence module. And notation is B of F, is just barcode of V of F. And the absolutely fundamental and non-trivial result in this area is a theorem by Cohen, Steiner, Edelsbrunner, and Harrer of 2007, that if we will consider the space of, let's say, Morse functions on X, smooth Morse functions with uniform norm to the space of barcodes with bottleneck distance, so the correspondence between F to the barcode of F is one Lipschitz, okay? So actually note that there is some kind of dissonance in what we are doing, right? So we consider smooth functions because we want to do more theory and so on, kind of to deal with nice sublevel sets, but with uniform norm. And so when you have, since you have a Lipschitz map, you can go to completion. So somehow you will, it's easy to describe what is completion of the set of bar codes, yeah? And then you will get a map defined on just continuous functions. And one of the kind of objects of interest for my talk is the number of bars in the barcode of length bigger than delta. So I will call it n delta of f. So basically ideology, at least one piece of ideology in the story is as follows, that in the barcode of function, right, so there are kind of very small oscillations and kind of large oscillations. So big long bars are responsible for large oscillations. Small bars are responsible for small oscillations. And these small oscillations, in my part of the story, it's kind of, I mean, there exist different viewpoints, are considered as topological junk, okay? So I'm kind of interested in the number of bars of length starting from given threshold, yeah, so which we fix, which is delta. Okay, and this viewpoint goes back to Cohen-Steiner, Edelsbrunner, and Mileika of 2000. So here is example. So let me do one example carefully. So what you see here is two-dimensional sphere S2. Okay, it has a form of a heart, yeah, and the function is just a height function. So let we see how sublevel set change. Yeah, so if we have kind of number t bigger than maximum, so sublevel set is just two-dimensional sphere. Okay, so two-dimensional sphere has two-dimensional homology, which is just the class of the sphere itself, and zero-dimensional homology, class of the point. Yeah, so nothing in H1. So then we chop the maximum, we have disk. So what happened? Of course, I mean, still zero-dimensional homology exists, but two-dimensional homology are killed because already you don't have the class of the sphere, okay? And nothing in H1 because, I mean, this cycle, for instance, which is represented by the boundary, is perfectly kind of the boundary of two-dimensional chain, which is the disk. But then when you chop the next local maximum, so you have a cylinder S1 cross R. And then you see that in addition to zero-dimensional homology to connected component, you have one-dimensional homology, right? Because this boundary connect component is already not homologous to zero. You cannot span it by anything, okay? But then when you pass through local minimum, you again get a disk. Okay, so H1 kills. And after the minimum, well, you get empty set, and my convention will be that homology of the empty set is just zero. Okay, so now let's bring this information kind of back. So we see that our barcode looks like this. So in H0, we have infinite ray, which starts at minimum. Because, I mean, if t is bigger than minimum, we always have a connected set, right? So in this class of the point persists. In first homology, right? So when we consider one-dimensional cycles, moduli boundaries, so first cycle appears at the local, at the saddle point, and dies at local maximum. Okay, so this is this interval. And H2 kind of appears starting from the maximum. So we basically kind of can read from this barcode the following information, that we have two infinite rays, and they basically reflect that in homology of S2, I mean, there is one-dimensional zero, zero, one dimensional homology in degree zero and one dimensional homology in degree two. And this finite bar in degree one, well, it reflects the point that we have a saddle point and local maximum. Okay. So that's kind of our main, that's an example when you can actually see everything, more or less, yeah. Okay, so now I said that we wish to kind of compare topology of functions as reflected in these barcodes, yeah, and geometry and slash analysis. So we do some geometric measurements of our function. So what we shall do, we'll fix the auxiliary Riemannian metric on the manifold and just look at Sobolev norms. So KP norms is basically LP norm of the kth derivative, okay? And we will assume that K is bigger than N over P because this, by Sobolev embedding theorem, this guarantees that our functions are continuous in such spaces. And our main result with Bukovsky, Payet, my brother Shulukin, and Stasavlevich is that n delta of f is less or equal than constant times delta in the power minus n over k times this kp Sobolev norm in the power n over k plus another constant. Okay, and so these constants kind of do not depend on f. So that's the and on f and delta, right? So that's the main thing. So somehow we can capture the magnitude of total magnitude of oscillation of our function in some sense, yeah, via its Sobolev norm. Okay, so now in the rest, kind of, we will discuss this result because I can imagine that. Result presented in this form, so it doesn't kind of cause any associations, so to say. Okay, so we will discuss two geometric formulations of this result, kind of two, I would say two geometric consequences of this result, which okay, I will clarify it. So, but first of all, it should be said that when p equals to infinity for uniform derivative bounds. This is a pretty kind of old story. So, I mean, there were no, of course, barcodes and no invariant and delta that time, yeah? But people were using some other kind of algebraic topological invariants, and they tried to relate them to this norm, uniform norm of the derivative. And the activity goes to works of Kronroth and Vitushkin in 50s and to a breakthrough work by Yossi Yomdin from 85. Okay, I will mention this work a little bit later. Okay, so then when k equals to one, so then we just look at the first derivative and p equals to infinity. So there was a kind of work by Cohen-Steiner, Edelsbrunner and Mileika, who already used n delta. So for n equals to two on surfaces and k equals to two, so two derivatives, and p equal to two, and p equal to two is an important case, which I will explain in a second why. We had a work which kind of proved more or less this inequality with Misha Sodin by using some geometric trick. And then we had a work with Osif Polterovich and Lukashin Stasavlevich, which basically extended and reformulated this result in the current form with the use of n delta, okay? So with the use of persistence. And at this point, for quite a long time, we get stuck because the geometric trick was absolutely two-dimensional, okay? So play with curves on surfaces. And now we have the full result, and actually generalizes in much bigger generality, so we can talk about oscillations of sections of vector bundles. And amazingly enough, so this problem, I mean, in some form appears in the problem book of Arnold of 2003, so it will be clear why Arnold was interested in this in a second. Okay, so let me very, very kind of briefly explain the idea of the proof. So it's completely kind of romantic explanation, but I wish just to mention some important points. So the idea is that first, I mean, this theorem is essentially known for polynomials, okay? So because you can estimate, you see in these barcodes, as you see in this picture, so endpoints of bars correspond to critical points of a function, right? So now for polynomials of given degree, you have estimate on the number of critical points, basically degree in the power of dimension. It was noticed by Milner, but that's basically some version of Bezout theory. Okay, and so then the idea is to approximate by polynomial on small cubes. So we chop the manifold into cubes, and by using estimate on the Sobolev norm, right, so we choose polynomial approximation. So this actually was the idea of Yomdin in 85, but again, in order to prove sharp bound, right, so for given Sobolev norm. So our innovation is that we use dyadic partition. So we chop in cubes of different sizes according to certain algorithm, and we know when to stop. And so then, we can stop in such a way that on each cube, the estimate will be kind of nice, yeah? But then we have to glue all these bounds by using a Meyer-Vietoris sequence, okay? And indeed, Yomdin also used Meyer-Vietoris in a kind of funny way. He didn't write down details, and basically when I kind of asked him why he did not write details, because he said that, but you know how to do it, yeah? So that's true. Indeed, I mean, what he wrote was absolutely correct. Okay, but we need a version of Meyer-Vietoris in different categories, so not just for homologies, but for persistence models. And this did not exist in 85. And the main tool is the following. So you see, I mean, there is a big difference in the linear algebra of vector spaces and persistence models. So in vector spaces, you know that every short exact sequence splits, right? So you have given a subspace, you have a transversal subspace. This is wrong in category of persistence modules. So you don't have kind of complementary persistence module. You have quotient, but not a complement. And this means that actually invariants of exact sequences are not so trivial. And what we proved, that if we have an exact sequence U to V to W, so then N to delta of V is less or equal than N delta of U plus N delta of W. And this estimate uses algebraic ideas, indeed kind of extension of persistence models inspired by the work of Scrabble and Turner of 2020. So that's basically how it works, okay? So let me now discuss some applications of this theorem. And again, one of the questions, how you can appreciate, so why you want to get estimate by using Sobolev norms and so on, okay? So one of the motivations comes from the following problem. So for a second, I will switch gears. So let M be a closed n-dimensional Riemannian manifold and F a smooth function. So we will denote by Z its nodal set, so just zero level set, and nodal domains are connected components of the complement to the zero level, so complement of M minus M. And we will introduce coarse nodal count. So MR of F delta is dimension of the following thing. So we consider dimension of the image of homology of the set where F is bigger than delta to the set M bigger than zero for given delta. So this is maybe a tricky definition, but let me give an example which will clarify things. So let's focus on M zero. So just on connected components, right? So then M0 of F delta is number of nodal domains where maximum of function is bigger than delta. So somehow general picture is the following. So we wish to measure how our function oscillates with respect to zero level, right? So we have the zero set, a complement is some connected components. So there are components where function is very small. So like here, I mean, where it's less than delta, so we discard it, we just don't count it. And there are components when function is big, so we declare this component to be deep. Yeah, and we count just such objects. And corollary of the main theorem is the following, that MR of F delta is bounded by the same thing. So delta in the power minus n over k, norm, Sobolev norm Kp of Kp of F in the power n over k, yeah, with some constants. And this count of nodal domains is brings us to a very kind of famous subject in spectral geometry. So assume that M is, okay, let's say closed Riemannian manifold, and we consider Laplace-Beltrami operator. The Laplace-Beltrami operator is just minus divergence of the gradient of a function. So for instance, on Euclidean torus, it's just usual Laplacian standard coordinate. I take it with the sign minus to get it positive. And it is known that this operator has discrete positive spectrum. And we denote by M0 of F number of nodal domains of such a function, okay? And here the following should be said. Actually, the geometry, so there is an extremely interesting problem in spectral geometry to understand geometry of nodal domain when lambda goes to infinity. So this set, as this picture shows, kind of, you see, I mean, you have nodal domains positive and negative, so sign is white or black, right? So you see that the pattern is extremely complicated. And my point is that we still do not have a proper geometric language which enables us to talk about geometry of nodal domains when lambda goes to infinity. So it's some kind of asymptotic geometry, right? So which we do not know. Another thing which should be said, that this nodal patterns entertained people for centuries. Yeah, so Kladny in Napoleon's salons, yeah, so entertained aristocracy by, you know, putting sand on the plates and somehow exciting this place by a bow, and so then you have vibrating plates. But of course, I mean, there are regions which correspond to zero sets which do not vibrate, so you can see this nodal pattern, yeah, so which are beautiful. So if one combines two famous results in spectral geometry, so current theorem and Weyl law, so one get the following known bound. M0 of F lambda is less or equal than constant times lambda plus one in the power n over two. And this is kind of asymptotically correct result. Okay, so n over two is the right number. And there was an old question, so whether current theorem, I mean, whether one can come up with a bound for number of nodal domains for linear combinations of eigenfunctions. So let us denote by F lambda span of eigenfunctions with eigenvalues less or equal than lambda. So then the theorem is the following, that for any delta bigger than zero and every F in F lambda and K bigger than n over two, so if F is normalized in L2 by one, so MR of F delta is less or equal than constant, which already, of course, depends on delta. And here you get lambda in the right asymptotics, asymptotics power n over two. And the fight was for this asymptotics. Yeah, so some number I can get by combining Yomdin with SOG, probably, kind of, so some known results, but power will be wrong. And if you want to get kind of correct power, so then you need this all this stuff which I explained. Yeah. So first of all, it's sharp and lambda. One can get examples where this is true. And there are some funny historical remarks on this quorum theorem for linear combinations. So first of all, it holds in dimension one. This is very old result by Sturm. So now in higher dimensions, this is known as Courant-Hermann conjecture. And interesting that it goes back to a flawed footnote in Courant-Hilbert famous book, right? So the footnote says that Courant student Hermann proved Courant theorem, so kind of bound for the number of nodal domains of eigenfunctions with the number j, right? So Courant proved that the number of nodal domains is less or equal than j plus one. Two linear combinations. And the point is that Hermann did not prove it. So he basically didn't do it at all. Okay, so God knows how this footnote appeared there. Nevertheless, Arnold became excited and was working on this, okay, at least making propaganda, probably thinking about this problem. So until in the 70s, Alekhverov, by using methods of real algebraic geometry, found a counterexample to a kind of finite statement, I mean, not asymptotic statements. And in 2020, Bukowski, Lugunov, and Misha Sodin completely killed the conjecture by exhibiting a sequence of actually eigenfunctions with infinitely many nodal domains, linear combinations of eigenfunctions with infinitely many nodal domains. Okay, so there is no chance to prove this result. But somehow, what we proved is a coarse reincarnation of this Courant-Hermann estimate, I would say, non-existent Courant-Hermann estimate, whose literally existence was killed by Bukowski, Lobanov, Sodin, yeah, but which appears in the coarse version. And another merit of this coarse version is that we basically use some Sobolev estimates for linear combinations of eigenfunctions, right? Because I started with the result which compares this n delta number with the Sobolev norm. So then you can make estimate for the Sobolev norm via lambda, right? And this is just some functional analysis, yeah, or PDEs, and then you can extend this result to much more general class of operators. So essentially extends to positive elliptic operators on manifolds, on vector bundles, and so on. Okay, so it seems to be an extremely general phenomenon. Okay, so that's kind of one piece of the story. And by the way, what I want to say that, remember that we have stability, right? So that barcodes of closed functions are closed, right? And so hence, if we know some estimate on the barcode for given function, so for function from a lambda, so we can prove, roughly speaking, the following thing, that if we have a function with kind of huge amount of huge magnitude of this number and delta, so then you cannot approximate it well by a function from F lambda. And let me bring your attention that to the fact that, for instance, on the torus, on the sphere, this linear combinations of eigenfunctions are just polynomials. Yeah, if torus is equipped with the Euclidean metric and let's say standard and standard torus, yeah, and sphere with the round spherical metric. So somehow we arrive to a topological approach to classical questions of approximation theory, right? So how you can approximate what is the optimal approximation of a given function by, let's say, polynomial of given degree, right? And this method gives some topological abstractions. And in dimension two, with the work with Iosif Polterovich and Pukashin Stasevlevich, we worked out it. So in this kind of big work, we were interested in other things. So we just tangentially mentioned existence of such application. Okay, so that's what I can say about nodal count. So there is a closely related problem, which is called Bizou problem. Okay, so what says Bizou theorem? That if you have D generic hypersurfaces in CPD, so then the number of intersection points is given by the product of their degrees. And natural question is the following. So can we extend the statement in the following direction? So first, intersection of zero sets of Laplace-Beltrami eigenfunctions of Riemannian manifold. So this is question which is inspired by Arnold, and it should be combined with a certain philosophy going back to Donnelly and Pfefferman, that eigenfunctions with the eigenvalue lambda are similar in some sense to polynomials of degree square root of lambda. And here I'm mentioning the subject which I probably will not talk about, intersection of affine submanifolds, and this is the transcendental Bizou problem, okay? And this intersection of affine submanifold is a problem which was pretty popular in the 70s, due to the work of Griffiths. And in the 70s, Carnalba and Schiffman found a counterexample to this. So in fact, Bizou theorem kind of does not hold in affine setting, right? So it holds in projective setting, but not in affine setting. So now for the first question, there is no written counterexample, but there is evidence that the answer is no, because of this example by Bukhovsky, Sodin, Logunov, which I mentioned above. Anyway, the point is that the answer becomes yes if one cuts small oscillations, so removes intersections which do not persist after a mild perturbation. And the tool is again persistence modules and barcodes. And I will show you a little piece of this story, kind of, which goes like this. So first of all, again, let MN be a closed Riemannian manifold if lambda span of eigenfunctions of Laplacian with eigenvalues less or equal than delta. So the Donnelly-Pfefferman philosophy is that functions of f lambda are similar to polynomial of degree square root of lambda. We look at zero set, and we consider the following example. So take sphere SN with round metric. Let F1Fn be generic eigenfunctions with the eigenvalue lambda equals to d times d plus n minus 1. So then Fj is just homogeneous polynomial of degree d on n plus 1, and the intersection of nodal sets can be estimated by the standard Bizou theorem. And this is constant in the power times lambda in the power n over 2. So again, I mean, you have this asymptotic n over 2, which is correct one, right? And actually, in random setting, so Gichev proved that expectation is actually of order lambda n over 2. So generically, I mean, this maximum is this maximal value is the one which you expect. And Hezer and Kazarnovsky extended this bound to certain homogeneous Riemannian manifolds. Okay, so now we wish to define coarse Bizou property. So we consider persistent intersection count, right? So we denote by if ZF is zero level of F, so Z0 of F delta is dimension of image H0 of ZF to H0 of absolute value of F less than delta. And So now we apply this in the following setting. So let f1fn be functions in f lambda, normalized by one in L2. And we will look at intersection of the corresponding nodal sets, so zero sets, as the zero set of sum of the squares in the power 1/2. So this function f, right, so just a 1 square plus et cetera plus fn square in the power 1/2 vanishes, of course, when all of these functions vanish. And so what we have to do, we want to study coarse number of zeros of this function. So here is a picture. So assume that I have, you see here, red nodal domain and green nodal domain, right? And so look, so this two points. So of course, I mean, they're different, right? So number two and three, but they lie in the same connected component of f less than delta. So we count them by one. And this point is of course, kind of survives in the f less than delta. So it's also counted by one. So coarse intersection count here is two and not three. So in a sense, we kind of count as one clusters of intersection. And so then the theorem is the following, that again, if k is greater or equal than n over two, so that zero of f delta is less or equal than c1 delta in the power n over k, lambda plus one in the power n over two plus c2, where again, this c1, c2 depend on n and k and metric. Okay, so that's the version of the coarse Bézout theorem for zero levels of eigenfunctions. Okay, and so I probably, as I said, I will skip this transcendental Bézout problem. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Leonid. Let us thank Leonid for his presentation, please. Okay, so let me stop the recording.